The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. If we know anything at all, it's the fact that we probably don't know anything. In medicine, yesterday's cure can become today's killer. In life, yesterday's villain can become today's hero. What can you depend on? Whom can you trust? Yourself? Who are you? What are you? Follow these questions to their logical conclusion, and you may get the shock of your life.
Would you please tell the court, what do you do for a living?
I'm unemployed.
And what is your profession, your trade? Isn't it a fact that you live by picking up lonesome middle-aged women, home, and then rob them?
No, that's
You're
a lie.
You're also able to blackmail them.
No, it's not true.
Unfortunately, in this case, Mrs. Wilson's husband came home unexpectedly.
No.
And you had to kill him.
Now, look, I'm being framed. Can't you see that, Your Honor? I'm being framed.
The state rests.
Our mystery drama, Lovers and Killers, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Sam Dan and stars Robert Dryden. It is sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division and Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, Brewers of Budweiser. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Nothing, said Benjamin Franklin, is certain but death and taxes. Of all the founding fathers, he was the wisest. But he should have known better. It's all very well to nod wisely, take a philosophical pull at one's pipe, and to compare truth to a quicksilver that can never quite be grasped. But there are, unfortunately, basic truths and complete certainties which have to be arrived at, especially if you are required to decide the question of life or death.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you have heard the charge. You will now retire to consider your verdict.
As foreman, it's my suggestion we begin by taking a vote and see how we stand. Now, you just write down on a piece of paper, innocent or guilty, and pass them up here. Now, let's see. I've got... Three innocents, three guilties, six don't knows. Well, I guess we got to talk about it. We'll go in order. I'm juror number one, but I'm foreman, so we'll start with juror number two. That's you, Mr. Miller. What would you like to say?
What would I like to say? I'd like to say goodbye. That's what I'd like to say. Goodbye, farewell, adios, so long. What am I doing here? Where do I come off being on a jury? Who needed this? I'm a chump, that's what I am.
Mr. Miller, what do you think?
I pass. So the vote's 3-3, 6 undecided. I'll wait to see which way it goes. Do I vote guilty? The guy can get life. Maybe the chair. And suppose he's innocent. What if I vote innocent? He goes free. And what if he really is guilty? I don't need this. Vicky, I just don't need this.
Yes, you do, David.
I need this like I need a case of jaundice.
Oh.
Vicky, I don't want any part of jury duty.
Why not?
I don't have the time. I'm going to get out of it.
David, it's your duty as a citizen.
Hold it. I'll put on a record of the Star-Spangled Banner.
David, listen.
Hello, Chuck. Yeah. Listen, Chuck, do me a favor. You got all the connections in the world, and I got a summons for jury duty. Now, how do I kill
him? David!
What? What do you mean it can't be fixed? Everything can be... All right. Okay, look, you'll have me in tears. Yeah, sure. Sure. Bye. He says I've got to get out of it myself.
David, tell me why.
Oh, for crying out loud. Do I have to explain it to you? This court where I have to report, they try murder cases. I could get stuck for weeks, months.
Look, David, I'm going to say this once. Each of us is something more than what he does for a living. Each of us is part of something that's more important than any of us. Part of a society. And we have to pay our dues to that society.
Hey, word for word, the second act curtain speech you did in Lovers and Killers.
Oh.
Honey, you can still get that dark, rich quality in your voice. Come on back. Do a play.
I won't say another word.
Vicky, I just can't spare the time.
You can get out of it, all right? When they question you, you can say you've been influenced one way or another. Oh, 100 things. You can get out of it.
And, baby, I will.
Oh, but please, David, don't. Oh, honey, there's things that all of us simply have to do. Or nothing will matter anymore.
David Michael Miller, El Chumpo. That's me. On account of her, I played it straight. 20 years, an actor's actor. Now I have a chance to make a fortune, something brand new, a singing act, a booking in Las Vegas. And where am I? In a jury room. I ask you, is that fair?
Why don't we all take a break and relax over a cup of coffee? Dave Miller?
Yeah?
Yeah, I'd like to talk to you on the QT. Dave, last vote was 6-5, 1 undecided. That's you.
I know.
Now, you can decide here and now how long this trial's going to run.
Me?
Yeah. It's a funny thing. It's all psychological. You know what I mean?
No.
Well, if you make it 7-5, we'll have a majority. And more important, a majority philosophy. See what I mean? A couple of the fives could have gone either way. Now, when they see a wind blowing steady in one direction, we could be 8-4, 9-3, even 10-2 by supper time. Tomorrow morning, we could wind it up. You see?
Yeah.
You know. Now, on the other hand, you make it 6-6. You could establish a deadlock philosophy. People get hardened in their attitudes, and we can be here forever. You want that to happen?
No.
The first thing you got to realize, you got to move off the undecided.
Yeah, yeah, I realize that.
You got to get off the fence, you know. Now, the defendant, is he guilty or innocent? What do you really think?
What do I really think? I don't know what I think.
Well, you go through that transcript again. You got to make up your mind. Maybe it can be changed later, but you got to come to some decision.
Okay. I'll try to figure it out somehow.
Maybe if I go through it all over again, all over again.
Tell the court your full name.
Richard, Richard Frederick Lenz.
You're a police officer? Attached to the North Precinct?
Yes, sir, I am.
And can you tell us where you were at 11 p.m. on the night of the 24th?
Yes, sir. I was driving a squad car on regular patrol. I received a radio message to proceed immediately to 81 Brentwood Lane. There was a report of a fight in progress.
How far were you from that address when the message arrived?
Less than 2 minutes. I pulled up, got out of the car, and I heard a shot.
Open it! I'm a police officer! Open the door! It's the police!
Oh, my husband!
Open the door!
The back way! He's running out the back way!
You there! Halt! Stop! That's a warning! Now freeze!
That's it. Now just keep your hands up high and don't move.
And who was that man?
The defendant there.
Howard Ingleside?
Yes, sir.
And he had the gun.
Look, I admit I had the gun. I was so confused. I didn't realize.
Ingleside, I must ask you to remain silent.
Your Honor, I never denied I had the
gun.
You will have
your turn. Continue, Mr. District Attorney.
What did you do then, officer?
I brought him back inside the house. The victim, Mr. Wilson, was lying on the floor, dead. And Mrs. Wilson, she must have fainted because she was on the floor, too.
And that's exactly what happened?
Yes, sir, that's what you'll find in my report.
Well, thank you, Officer Lance. The people call Mrs. Myra Wilson. Mrs. Wilson, what happened the night of the 24th?
Oh, please, I find it so hard to talk.
Yes, we realize that, Mrs. Wilson. We know it's difficult, but it's necessary. We shall be as brief as possible. The night of the 24th.
The night of the 24th. That night, I was alone in the house, and I wasn't accustomed... Well, you see, Gerald, my husband, my late husband, he'd never leave me alone because I'm frightened. I can't help it. I'm a person whom everything frightens. I've always been that way. Maybe it's a sickness, but I just have to live with it. Well, I was sitting in the living room, reading, and I thought my heart would stop. I was so frightened. It was a noise, but I thought I'd have to scream or call for the police, but suddenly the phone rang. Hello?
Myra?
Oh, Gerald. Oh, Gerald, darling.
Myra, what is it?
Yes. There's someone in the house.
Myra, are you sure? Are you sure it's not your imagination?
Oh, I don't know.
Now, don't be frightened.
I'll try.
Look, this was an extremely important meeting.
Oh, I understand.
And it's just winding up. I'll be through here in a little while. Darling, you're just going to have to learn to cope.
Yes.
Why don't you listen to some music?
Yes, dear.
Really, there's nothing to be afraid of.
Yes, Gerald.
Goodbye, darling. I'll be home before you know it.
Goodbye. Well, Gerald's right. He's right. I've just simply got to get up. Who's there? Who's there? Who? There's no one here. It's the roof. It's the wind. It's... Who are you?
Shut up.
Who are you?
Get away from that phone.
Please. Who are you? What do you want? Don't hurt me.
Shut up. Look, let's turn this on. Play some music. There you are now. Just relax.
Please, we have no money in the house. I have my purse here. Here's $20. Just take it. I don't have any jewels or anything.
Just shut up, please.
Do you want silver? We have silver. We have a sterling silver service for eight, and it's hardly ever been used. Take it.
No, I don't want your silver.
Oh, then what do you want?
I want you to come over here, huh?
No.
Baby?
No, you don't want me. You wouldn't want me. I'm a middle-aged woman.
I said, come here.
No. Oh, don't kill me. Please.
I don't want to kill you, baby.
I'll die of shame.
Will you calm down?
Please.
Relax.
My husband, he's on his way home. He carries a gun. He'll kill you.
Nothing to be scared of.
If he finds you here, he'll kill you. So get away. Please, get away.
Will you shut up?
Help.
Let go of her.
Gerald. I'll kill him. Look out, Gerald. Be careful.
Drop that gun, buddy. Drop it. Help me, Myra. Help me. Now we'll see who killed...
Don't kill him! Don't kill him!
Open up! Open up! It's a police officer!
You killed him! You killed him!
Open the door! It's the police!
My husband has been murdered!
And then, Mrs. Wilson,
He ran out the back and I screamed at her. That's all I know.
But she is lying. That's not how it happened. Your Honor, I didn't break into the house.
You will have your turn on the stand.
Your Honor, she picked me up in a bar near where they live.
Order!
Yes, indeed. Order. And what order of proceedings are taking place here? Do you see where this is going? Well, that's why we have courts of law and trials and testimony to establish the truth. Truth. Keep that concept uppermost, and I shall return shortly with Act Two. Justice, it is said, is truth in action. Well, we're in the right place. We're in a court of law where a man is being tried for murder. And we're seeing it all through the eyes of juror number two, Mr. David Michael Miller. The problem is, although he's looking very hard, he can't be sure of what he's seeing.
Miss Walton, prior to the time the defendant broke into your home, had you ever seen him before?
Him? That man?
Yes, Miss Wilson, that man seated at the table. The defendant, Howard Ingleside.
No, I never saw him before in my life.
Thank you, Miss Wilson. We can all appreciate how difficult this must be. I have no further questions.
Dave Miller?
Yeah.
Dave, I think it's time we had another vote, but,
What?
Well, I've been sounding out the others. It's still 6-5, so unless you're willing to move off dead center, there's no use.
Mr. Foreman, I just started reading this transcript again, and, well, why don't you have everyone read it through again?
All right, Dave. Nobody's pushing you at this time.
Why don't I vote one way or the other? Everybody's looking at me, waiting for me. If I vote, no matter how, I can break this jam. We can be out of here in a day, 2 days tops. Why don't I vote? Because I don't know how to vote. I just went over her story again. Let me go over his story again.
I just happened to stop in at this bar. It was kind of crowded, you know. And I saw her. That is, I saw a girl sitting all the way over at the end of the bar. She gave me the eye, so I moved in. When I got close up, I saw maybe she wasn't such a girl, but good-looking enough. The kind that's out for a little fun, you know. So I said, hi.
Hi yourself.
What do you say to a little drink?
Hello, little drink.
Ooh. You know all the answers.
You know all the questions.
Come in here often?
Hmm? First time.
First time for me, too. Bartender, same way again. What's your name?
Myra.
Miss Myra or Mrs.?
Ms.
Call me Howard.
Howard. Myra and Howard. That would be a new combo. We've had John and Mary and George and Martha and now Howard and Myra.
It's got a kind of a ring to it.
What do you do, Howard?
Nothing.
Oh, I see you go to bars and pick up lonely middle-aged ladies.
Beats going on welfare. Besides, you don't look so middle-aged.
You know what Ben Franklin said? Always make love to an older woman. She'll be so grateful.
Really? Did Ben Franklin say that?
Could have been H.L. Mencken or Voltaire. Have you ever read anything by Voltaire?
No.
Ever read anything by anybody?
Not an awful lot.
Oh, good-looking fella like you. You should have gone to college. You might have gone far.
Oh, I did go to college. I went there to play football.
Oh, and were you a hero?
Didn't get the chance. See, I broke a leg. I was never the same afterwards.
Oh, and then what did you do?
Hit you in the Marines.
And after that?
I took this job, picking up lonely middle-aged ladies in saloons.
What do you think of this place?
It's crowded.
Noisy.
Yeah, I think the guy cuts the booze.
We deserve better.
What'd you have in mind?
Come with me. How's this?
Well, nice layout.
You like classical music?
Whatever turns you on, baby.
Hey, drink up.
You, live here alone?
Mm-mm. Friend husband.
Ooh, and where is friend husband this evening?
Portland.
Maine or Oregon?
He told me, but I forgot.
Well, they're both about the same distance from here.
Well, here's to Portland.
And here's to us.
Come over here.
Meet me halfway?
Let's take it from there.
And, friend husband?
Not due till Friday night.
That's 3 days from now.
Or maybe Saturday. I forget which.
I just hate to have him walk in, you know?
You could break friend husband in half.
That's not the point.
Oh, but it is the point. Oh, yes, indeed. It's very much the point. You see, what I'm stuck with is Melvin W. Milquetoast. I was very young when I married friend husband.
Honey, I can see a crying Jack coming on.
I was in college, and he was rich. Very rich.
Yeah, baby, why don't we just leave him in Portland?
My mama said to me, "Dear, you'll have everything your heart desires. Money, clothes, beautiful house, servants."
Yeah, servants. Incidentally, where are they? Servants,
Maid's night out. She and I both take Thursdays off. I don't know where she goes. Mm. And I can tell you, she doesn't know where I go.
Well, bottoms up.
You know who I am?
Mm-hmm.
I'm Myra Wilson. I'm Mrs. Gerald Prescott Wilson. Ah, I am the president of the United League. I am the secretary of the Willard County Poetry Society. You know I write poetry?
Is that a fact?
I am very active in every imaginable community project. And do you know why?
Why?
It's his fault. No, it's not his fault. He can't help himself. It's my mother's fault. My mother convinced me to marry him, and after I did, I said to her, "Mom, there's no excitement with him."
Yeah, I know
and
what
Mama
you mean.
Said, she said that sort of thing isn't really very important. Oh, I need a drink.
Hey, baby, you may have had enough.
Howard, please believe me.
I believe you, baby.
No, you don't. I haven't told you anything yet.
You've told me everything. Friend husband isn't exciting, so what can you do for excitement? You have to take it where you find it, right?
But I'm not like other women who sit around in a bar.
Oh, of course not.
Don't make fun of me, Howard. Why did he marry me if he wasn't interested? If he didn't care about that...
Well, baby, why did you stay with him?
Well, that's a good question. But what else is there for me to do? Get a job, but at what? You know what it is to be my age and unmarried? No, at least this way I misses somebody. Howard. Howard, could you love me?
Honey, I can give you references. Satisfaction guaranteed.
Oh, no, I mean love me, Howard. I don't mean just tonight. Howard, I need somebody. I need somebody so badly.
Sure, baby, sure.
Hold me in your arms.
Of course.
Am I attractive?
Oh, baby, you're beautiful.
Am I desirable?
You don't have to say anything. You don't have to say another word.
Howard, let me confess something
later,
to you.
Later, later,
this
baby.
Is the first time I ever...
It doesn't matter.
Oh, it matters. I've gone to bars, you know, every Thursday night, and I'd sit there... But this is the first time I ever brought anyone home.
Sure, I understand that.
Howard, oh,
love me. Love me.
What the devil is this?
Jerry! Jerry!
Hey, ain't you supposed to be in Portland?
This is
you. This is up to your old tricks.
Well, folks, three's a crowd.
I decided not to go to the convention.
Yeah, see you folks around.
Oh, no, Howard, don't go.
Don't go.
You'll kill me.
Well, sure,
please,
but I can't really...
Please, Howard, don't
Young man, I don't know who you are, and it doesn't make any difference. I have nothing against you. You could have been anyone. It isn't your fault. I don't even blame you.
That's pretty broad-minded. I
must ask you to leave.
Yeah, that's a great idea. Well, good night.
Please, don't let him kill me.
Look, he's not going to kill
will.
You.
No, he will. He will.
Okay.
He said he would. He said the next time.
The next time? What? You mean he's come home unexpected from Portland before?
Young men, leave this house at once.
No, please, Howard, help me.
If you want to watch this.
Watch
me shoot my wife.
In that drawer, he keeps a gun. Gerald,
hey!
Well,
please.
Young man.
Mr. Hey, one of those things can go off and kill people, you
yes,
know?
Of course.
Don't, Howard. I don't want to die.
Look, Mr. We ought to talk it over.
What?
Right?
Talk what over? She's trash, and you know
yeah,
it.
Well, still,
don't,
no,
Gerald, please don't.
You deserve it.
I'll never do it again.
Oh, I've heard
never,
that before.
Never.
I'm sorry. No, I'm not. I'm glad. I'm finally doing what has to be done.
Gerald, you'll be so proud of me.
There's a law, my dear Myra, against adultery. A law. And how many times have you broken it?
Well, as far
please.
As that goes, Jerry, you know there's a law against murder.
Keep out of this.
Please.
Mister, you're
listen
not going
to
kill
him,
her.
Jerry, please.
Young man, you don't know what she's done.
It doesn't matter what she's done. You've never killed anybody. You don't know what it is.
That's enough.
Listen to him.
You'll have nightmares
sense,
all your life.
I don't care.
I'll change. I promise you, you'll see. We'll have a wonderful life together. I'll be someone absolutely different.
It's too late,
please,
Myra.
Jerry,
this
please.
Guy is crazy. He's written back.
Please.
Will you put down that gun? Don't make me kill you, too.
Put it down.
I didn't murder anybody.
Murderer.
Listen, I had to do this
murderer.
To save your life. Well, I am getting out of here.
The back way. He's running out the back way.
Well, we've heard the last scene told three times. Once by the police officer, once by Myra Wilson, and now by Howard Ingleside. Everyone who has seen it differently. How did you see it? Someone is telling the truth, but who? I'll be back with Act 3 in just a few moments. You know the ancient story of the blind men and the elephant? Well, this is not an elephant. It's a murder case. And the people are considering the facts in evidence. And all of them can see. But what are they looking at? Where is the truth? What is the truth? Can truth even exist?
And so, Mr. Ingleside, you'd have this court believe that you picked Mrs. Wilson up in a bar and she invited you to her home.
That's what happened.
The bartender testified that he cannot remember seeing you or Mrs. Wilson that night.
Well, look, the place was jammed. I'm not a regular. How could he remember me?
Well, then really, all we have is your own word. Your word against Mrs. Wilson.
Well, my word's as good as hers.
Is it? I wonder. That's for the jury to decide.
Dave, you finished rereading all the testimony?
I guess so.
You ready to vote?
No.
Well, then you better be ready to argue.
Argue. There were those who said innocent and those who said guilty. But I couldn't say anything. So I had everybody on my back.
Who are you going to believe? A woman who's respectable, who doesn't have so much as a whisper scandal about her.
I didn't say she was lying.
Let me finish. A woman who plays around. You don't keep it quiet. Somebody knows this talk. There has to be. Now, nobody can prove Mrs. Wilson was of anything than an honest, decent person. But on the other hand, who's a man? A bum.
Well, now, just hold on. Who says he's a bum?
He does. He admits to preying on women.
But he's not preying on women. He's only offering a certain service women are willing to pay for.
And that doesn't make him a bum.
Well, even if it does, that's not what he's being tried
for. Let me tell you what happened. He's broke. He was prowling around this wealthy neighborhood. He saw a chance to steal something. So he managed to get into the house. But when he saw her, she aroused
but how him. How do you know? Were you there?
Nobody was there. We got the evidence.
What evidence? Here you have a sex-starved lady.
Just because he says so?
That's how the arguments went. He said, she said. There were 12 of us in that room. 11 had already decided one way or the other. But I could tell, no one was really married to his decision. Somehow, everyone had turned to me. I was the undecided one. For some reason, they believed that when I would finally make up my mind, that would be the right decision. What was I doing here, anyhow? I told Vicky, I told her, damn it, I don't know enough to be on a jury.
David, what do you have to know?
Well, something about law and rules of evidence, that sort of stuff.
No, the lawyers worry about that. The lawyers and the judge. You only have to decide who's telling the truth.
But I'm not qualified to do that.
Oh, you're as qualified as anybody else.
Vicky, I still say I ought to get out of this thing.
All right, go ahead. But I warn you, David, don't you ever complain to me about anything for the rest of your life, about justice, the courts, politics, the government.
Okay, don't make a production out of it.
It is a production, the most important production we have.
I said I would do it. And I did. What do I do now? There was a lot of legal gobbledygook, motions, objections, opinions, rulings. Well, that was all for the lawyers. Vicky was right. All we had to do was decide who was telling the truth. And I couldn't do anything. When I listened to Myra Wilson, I believed her.
I was alone in the house, and I thought I heard of it. Who are you?
Shut up.
Don't hurt me.
Calm down.
Do you want silver? We have silver.
Come over here.
No, you don't want me. Why would you want me? I'm a middle-aged woman. Don't kill me.
I don't want to kill you.
Die. I'll die of shame. Let me go.
And when I listened to Howard Ingleside, I believed him.
What's your name?
Myra.
Call me Howard.
Howard. Myra and Howard. That would be a new combo. John and Mary. George and Martha. Now, Myra and Howard.
It's got a kind of a ring to it.
What do you do, Howard?
Nothing.
You go to bars and pick up lonely middle-aged ladies?
Beats going on relief.
Always make love to an older woman. She'll be so grateful.
Just as I'd start believing him, I'd see her face again on the stand. The terror, as she described...
Let me go. Let me go.
Calm down, please.
My husband, he's on his way home. He carries a gun.
Take it easy, honey.
If he finds you here, he'll kill you.
Now, hold still.
No.
And just as I thought she had me, I remembered the look on his face, the tone in his voice.
Where's friend husband?
Portland.
Maine or Oregon?
They're both the same distance from here.
I'd hate to have friend husband walk in, you know?
You could break friend husband in half. I'm married to Melvin W. Milktoast. Oh, Howard, could you love me?
Satisfaction guaranteed.
Love me, Howard. Love me.
And that's how it went, back and forth, back and forth. In a crazy kind of way, I knew something like this could very likely happen. I'd even mentioned it to Vicky. It was my last shot before leaving home that day. Vicky, let me tell you why I don't want to be on a jury. Really.
Really? All right, darling. Tell me really.
It's because I'm a sucker.
You can be called many things, but certainly not sucker.
No, what I mean is, I'm a sucker for a good performance. You know me. I sit in a theater and someone up on that stage...
But you won't be in a theater. You'll be in a courtroom.
Well, it's the same thing. I never listen to what they're saying, only to how they say it.
Oh, David, you know as well as I do. The performance has to have truth, or else it just doesn't work.
Now, you can believe that.
I do.
Well, we disagree.
Maybe. But if you believed it, it would open up new horizons to your acting career.
Now, look, let's not get off into that.
Oh, darling, it's part of the same thing. How extremely qualified you are to be a juror.
What makes me qualified?
Look, let me put it on your terms. You just said a courtroom is like a theater, right? All right, now let's assume that's true. Then the trial is a play. The judge, the lawyers, the witnesses, the accuser, the accused, all of them are actors. Oh, honey, trust your instinct.
What instinct?
Your theatrical instinct. No one has a better one. Who has your ability to examine a play and spot the flaws?
No, wait a minute. You make it sound too pat.
Every word spoken at that trial will be recorded. It'll be on a transcript. Transcript. The second part of that word is script. When the performances confuse you, look at the script. Analyze the script. Oh, come on, darling. Nobody's ever fooled you.
You know something? You're going to sell me yet.
David, do it. You need it for a selfish reason.
Yeah?
Yes. For years now, well, you've lived in the world of artificial drama. Get some new experiences and get them firsthand. Take a part in a real play.
Wow, when you get wound up...
Oh, you'll thank me, David, you'll see.
But it was not a real play. That is, a real play on the stage. Because a real play on the stage is a work of art. And you know all about art. You yourself told me every great work of art has a tiny flaw. Something to contrast with that perfection. Something that lets you grasp it. It isn't here, Vicky. It isn't here. Sure, I know my theater inside out. All theater begins as a mystery, and every play still has a mystery at the heart of it. When you see a good murder play in the theater, the playwright gives you clues. If you watch it carefully, this beautiful piece of tapestry, you can spot the scene. Where and how it was all put together. But here, there is no flaw, no seam. There are 12 of us, and none of us can find it.
That's not true, Dave. We have people here who've made up their minds. You're the only undecided.
Made up their minds on the basis of what?
The evidence.
What evidence? The same evidence has called for 2 different conclusions.
Dave, we have to come to a conclusion. What is it? Are you scared to take a position?
I've been through this transcript.
Oh, well, I know.
Not just once.
Well, you can say that again.
There are thousands and thousands of words here. But you know what it all rests on? The last 3 lines of dialogue. When the district attorney wound up his cross-examination of Howard Ingleside, it was his word against Mrs. Wilson's.
That's what it comes down to. That's what everything comes down to. So, how are you going to vote, Dave? You'll swing this jury.
How? If everybody already believes...
Because your belief is stronger.
Why? How do you know?
I can feel it.
You're crazy.
Dave, there's really no evidence. In most murder cases, unless witnesses actually have seen the fellow do it, it all becomes a matter of who tells the better story. Oh, sure, the rest of us, all 11 of us, have decided for or against. You know why?
No. You tell me.
Because of our prejudices. Who we are, how we think, what we would like to be true.
And what do you really think, Mr. Foreman?
I think Howard's telling the truth.
Why?
Maybe I don't care for the look in Mrs. Wilson's eye. Maybe because my son was in the Marines. Maybe because... Well, I wish I were his age again, picking up women.
And that's why he's innocent?
For me. You know why he's guilty for Mrs. Perkins?
I heard what she said. Mrs. Wilson's spotless reputation.
Did you watch her face during the trial? She kept looking at the defendant with... I mean,
It was fear. Maybe disgust in her eyes. What was she thinking of? Dave, get us out of here. We believe you. We trust you. We don't know either. We need a leader.
You're the leader.
I'm just a foreman. You're the leader. We trust you.
Why?
Beats me, Dave. But we need your vote. Decide. One way or another.
Suppose I say he's guilty. Suppose I believe it.
We could accept that.
And what if, later, it should turn out he was innocent?
If that's what's bothering you, vote to acquit him.
No. That'd mean I voted for it because I was scared.
Well, then let's find him guilty.
Oh, what a way to administer justice.
Dave, is there a better way?
The truth is, I just don't know.
You want this thing to end in a hung jury? They'll only have to do it again.
Okay, that's the way out.
In other words, you don't have the guts.
It isn't that.
You have a war record. You went. Maybe you didn't like the idea of it, but you went. You did what you had to do.
But it's not the same thing.
Right now, deep down, way down in your heart, you know what you believe. Don't you? Well, Dave, people have to stand up and be counted.
Yeah. You have to stand up and be counted.
Okay. And that's all we need. You want me to call for the vote? Dave?
Yeah. You can call for a vote.
And they voted. And by the end of the day, they were unanimous. And they returned to the courtroom with their verdict. And what was the verdict? Well, what was your verdict? You know everything they knew. You were the rest of the jury. How did you vote? Whichever way, be sure to vote for me, for I shall return shortly. One person, and only one person, knew the truth, and he was Gerald Wilson, but he was dead. Therefore, we will never really know, will we? But think of so many of the great trials and vital matters of public dispute during the recent past. Is everyone satisfied with the endings? Don't most of us keep asking, did he or didn't he? Was she or wasn't she? Maybe the truth is like quicksilver, elusive, mysterious. Impossible to hold. Our cast included Robert Dryden, Russell Horton, Marion Seldes, E.V. Juster, and Robert Maxwell. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by True Value Hardware Stores. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.